Hi, and welcome to Digital Savvy Parenting, Should You Monitor? Presented by Your Teen Media and Verizon. Today is the second of a four-part webinar series on technology and teenagers. I'm Jennifer Cohen, and I'll be moderating today's discussion. Thank you all for joining us tonight. Before we begin, a few housekeeping notes so that our webinar works flawlessly for you. First of all, we'd really like you to participate in our chat section. You're going to find that on the bottom right hand of your screen, and you can type in your comments, your questions, whatever's on your mind. Sue Borison, sitting right here, is the editor of Your Teen Media, and she's going to be driving the chat and responding and monitoring. So if anything comes up, we'll interrupt our panelists and ask them some of your questions. We'll also use it at the end of the webinar when we have our Q&A section. Some technical difficulties that you might encounter, which we actually just went through right before we went live. To help you have a good webinar, we really recommend that you switch to your Chrome browser. That will make things go a lot easier for you. Turn off all applications on your device and make sure that no one else is streaming anything, particularly on your wireless system. And in the worst case, don't worry, because we're videotaping this webinar and we'll be sending it out in about 3 days. So you'll be able to view it if for some reason you can't participate tonight. And for those of you who like to tweet, please use hashtag Tech4Parents. And the four is a number, not spelled out. So hashtag Tech4Parents. We also have a really great contest, and we're going to be raffling off this Moto X phone that's been provided by Verizon. So one lucky winner is going to get it. So when you submit your questions on our chat, you're going to be automatically entered into our raffle. And we're going to announce that winner when we send out the email with the videotape. So it's really exciting, very nice, and we want to thank Verizon for providing that to us. All right, so we're going to move on, and we're going to introduce our esteemed panelists. We have Hemanshu Nigam. He is actually in California, and I don't know if you get to see him yet or not. Yep, all right. So good. Hemanshu is the founder of SSP Blue, the leading advisory firm for online safety, security, and privacy challenges that many corporations and governments face. We also have Amy Speidel sitting right here with me, and she is a certified parenting coach through Coactive Coaches Training Institute and a certified conscious discipline instructor. Thank you both for being here. The way the program is going to work tonight is Hemanshu is going to introduce four different parenting styles, and we're actually going to take them one at a time. Hemanshu's going to present one. He's going to talk about that style and actually some of the different type of monitoring that might support that parenting style. Then we're going to have Amy share with us some of her insights and experiences and perspectives on what you might want to consider based on that parenting style and the monitoring that might go on, and actually the relationship and the impact that it's going to have with your children. So what might be positives, what might be negatives, things that you want to consider, how it can impact trust. And so I think all of us are going to be very interested to figure out which parenting style we're doing right now, and maybe we might want to shift and try something different or new. So I'm really looking forward to this. Being a parent of my own three kids, I want to see what type I'm at and where maybe I need to improve. All right, so we're going to turn this over to Hemanshu, and he's going to share with us the very first parenting style.
I want to thank our presenters, which are Verizon Wireless, as well as Parent Teen Media, because you all who are watching, Susan has done an amazing job in getting information out there, and Verizon Wireless, being one of the presenters, has provided a great deal of resources, and just the fact that they're involved in this discussion shows you their commitment. And I would recommend, since every one of you out there who's watching or listening has a mobile device of some kind, you know you're using either Verizon, AT&T, T-Mobile, Sprint, whatever it is out there, but Verizon in particular has a family safety section on their website that you ought to visit no matter what. And I think Susan can put that up on the screen or something like that, or she'll send it out later, but make sure you do that. Now, going back to what kind of parent you are, and the first one, I'm going to actually talk about it a little bit differently. And that is to ask you, who's listening, what kind of parents did you have? Not what kind of parent you are, but what kind of parent did you have? And what that means is think back to your childhood and ask yourself, and this is going to be, and there's, I'm sure some of you are going to be raising your hand or nodding, even though I can't see the hand going up, I can feel it. Some of you have been in a household where they're talking on the phone when you're little, or you're a teenager, and all of a sudden you hear this little click go on, or some noise, and you say to yourself, wait a minute, is somebody listening on the other line? And then you shout at the top of your lungs, Ma, what are you doing? And then there's another click that turns it right off. And you find out that maybe you have a mother or father who likes to, what do we call it, spy on you, or listen to everything you're saying. That's how she understands you better, figures out what's going on in your life, and then decides what kind of parent she's going to be with you and what kind of interaction or intervention she may run on you. Now, that's in the physical world. So now let's take that to present day. You're now a parent. You have your own teenagers, and you're thinking, do I pick up that phone? Or are you thinking, do I look at that text? Maybe they'll put the phone down. I've been watching their password when they punch in those four little numbers. I can figure it out and then go in and check and see what are they doing? What are they talking about? Who are they talking to? All of those kinds of things. And there's a parenting style that actually, honestly, does work in certain households. And when it comes to technology, the question becomes, what type of technology is out there to help you engage in that kind of parenting? And there's all sorts of different software out there. We did put together the top two or three in each of the categories we're going to talk about. But in particular, there is some that can literally monitor everything your child is doing, or your teenager especially. What are they typing? It can show you on your own screen. Who are they talking to? It'll show you. What website did they visit? Exactly. What did they look at on that website? It will show you. It's oftentimes called keystroke logging. Other times people call it spyware and things like that. But there's different software names. I can point one out to you. I'm going to look down. I don't like doing this on camera, but I did find one in particular that we thought would be worth it. And there are a few in each category, but we thought we'd bring out just one in each one. In this case, it's actually called Spy Agent, and it works both on your laptop and your desktop. And so with that, let me stop that there for a second and then turn it back to Jen, because I think she's maybe hitting us up with some questions.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. So, Amy, I'd love to hear your perspective on this type of parenting style, you know, where the parent's really helicoptering, really looking in, following their kids, and the impact that it has on the relationship.
So what I would say about monitoring, if you either do this or if you're thinking that this is going to be the plan for you, is that you're upfront about it. And the reason for that is that this allows you to have a discussion as to why it is that I believe that this is a viable and a responsible piece for us to provide for you and your safety as our team. Mm-hmm. And that gives that parent and that child an opportunity to have a dialogue about why it is that we believe that this is important. And I think, you know, the piece for us is that we think that then they're going to say, well, okay, if that's the way that our family is and this is what we're going to do. And of course, they are going to come kicking and screaming. And the reason for that is nobody wants to be controlled. No one does. So from the time we're born and we're sticking kids into car seats to the time we get old and our kids take away the car keys, we don't want somebody else being in charge of us. And yeah.
I was going to say, is there times, you know, I always wondered, like I always envied people who did this and put a lot of energy into it and knew all the things that they could do to monitor their kids. But I almost kind of felt like maybe should you hold off and save that for a different time, for maybe when they've done something wrong and that's kind of the last thing, you know, what you have in your back pocket to pull out. You know, is there a time when this is appropriate to start this way or is it better to hold off?
You can do it. I think that it can be a viable plan either way. If you decide that this is the way you're going to go, then it creates as soon as electronics are introduced into our home or as soon as we bring them in, this is the plan because we have always maintained a belief that our job is to keep you safe and we mm-hmm. believe that our monitoring does indeed ensure that. And that's the way we want to do it. Mm-hmm. So it's more about saying, I choose to bring the proactive plan into it instead of waiting for you to prove that you can't handle it.
the advantage to this is it sets up a belief that this isn't about trust. This is just about the way that we do it.
Oh, so it takes it out from the beginning because it's just
how we believe
it. Okay.
Yeah, and some of the things that you might hear with kids is other parents don't do this, and nobody else, you know, does all this. And the standard line isn't to defend yourself or to try to make them understand that you're wise in doing it. It's just to say, and we're not those parents, and so we do it differently.
Okay.
I do want to add one other little piece to this too, and that is that I think that it's important that kids know you're monitoring them, and the reason for that is spying is a whole different thing, and that creates distrust between the parties. But there's another piece. It allows you, by saying we're going to be monitoring what you do, it brings in accountability. So you actually lose that edge of accountability if you don't tell them you're monitoring them.
Should you actually do the monitoring in front of them? Like, should you say, let's look through your texts together, or should you do it privately?
I think you can just let them know that we're going to be checking in, and we're going to do that pretty consistently. So if there are things that you're putting on that you wouldn't want us to read, then perhaps they shouldn't be there. And we're doing it so that we can maintain safety in our home, and we believe that that is essential. So it's a plan. It might not be for every family, it might not be for every kid, but it certainly is. If you're doing it respectfully, then it can work.
Okay, great. Hemu, do you want to take over and share the second parenting style?
So while we're waiting for Hemu to come on,
do you have a question?
I just want to say that someone commented, Kim commented here that conversing is another way to monitor rather than spying. So that's a running theme here, correct?
Exactly.
Great. Okay. Amy, are you back with us?
Yeah, I'm here. I had turned my mic off. I forgot. what I wanted to add to that was one of the things that was really interesting in what you just heard is that some people may call it spying, but if you're telling your teenager that you are doing this, you're having a conversation in the first place. You're showing that you care, and in a way, you're planting a knowledge base in their mind that says, you know, my mother, my father, they're with me, they're kind of watching, and in a sense, you're teaching self-control over what's going on, and a step back, and let me think this through before I take any action. Now, let's turn to another kind of parenting. And again, let's go back to when you were little, and I remember there's times that, and I'm sure it happened to some of you, especially some of the women who are watching when you were younger, you were a teenager, you're about to leave the house, and immediately, wait a minute, where are you going? Who's going to be there? What are you going to do? Who's giving you a ride? Who's picking you up? Wait a minute, what are you wearing? All of these kinds of questions get thrown at you one by one by one by one, and you get 2 seconds to answer, and then at the end of it, it's like, okay, honey, make sure you're home by 9:30 or 11 or whatever time your curfew was. And in a sense, what your parents are doing is assessing the situation. They're examining what's going on in what's in front of them. They're asking questions to get more knowledge about it, and then they were telling you their thoughts on it, or perhaps they were setting down a rule for you. Well, you can have a ride with Brandy, but not with Brenda, because Brenda has gotten into a car accident. We're not quite sure you want to drive with Brenda. It could be something as simple as that, but there's assessing each situation individually. So let's now pass forward to today. You're in your digital world, and the question becomes, how do you become that same parent in the digital world? And if you notice your actions, if you are one of these types of parents, you are doing those similar kinds of things. Instead of saying, who are you talking to on the phone, what you're saying is, who are you texting with? Is it a group text? Why are you texting at 10 p.m. at night? What about at midnight? Why don't you stop at 9 p.m.? Where are you going to go after? Are you planning something? And let me see that text. Every now and then, you might step in and not become that full-fledged monitor everything, but assess the situation and decide, in this particular instance, I need to learn a little bit more than what I'm just hearing from my child. And that's a different kind of parent. It creates a different kind of relationship, which I'm sure Amy's going to talk more in depth about, but it is something to be aware of. Now, what kind of tools are out there for this? Well, one of them is AVG, that's Adam Victor Gary, AVG Family Safety. And if you find it, and these and every one of them we're giving you tonight, work on your PC, your laptop, or the mobile device. They're created for both for a reason. And so we didn't actually choose ones that were one or the other, or didn't have an Android version and things like that. So we're making sure that these have all versions available because that just makes it easier for everyone listening rather than singling a section of our viewers out. So that's another kind of parent. It's another kind of software. It's another kind of approach. And think back to when you were little. Bring it to your digital world today and see. Ask yourself, are you the kind that assesses the situation, determines whether to get really engaged, somewhat engaged, but most of all is asking questions then deciding what to do next.
So one question for Hemu is that not all parents are tech savvy. So what would you say to a parent who is wanting some kind of monitoring system but doesn't feel competent to put that on the devices?
So there's actually two things I would say. One is the best, most amazing technology educators in America are, guess what? Sitting at dinner, at your dinner table every single night, having dinner with you. And if you ask your kids to teach you things about the online world, the digital space, the new apps that are out, the new ways the phone works, where the settings are, they will tell you happily because now they know more than you. And they'll share it with you. And in that process, you can learn a lot more than you can imagine. So for example, take an Android phone, an iPhone. Many of these devices have settings inside them that tell you how to control things. And in that process, you can say, look, again, goes back to the conversation. You are letting your kids know what you're about to do, but they will help you in understanding the digital side, which will make you more comfortable, won't want you to throw your hands in the air and say, I can't do this, because you absolutely can. And if you don't feel comfortable doing that, the great thing about a lot of these technology stores, everything from, and I'm not going to endorse them, but let me use their names, things like Best Buy's and the iPhone stores and other stores out there are all offering free tech folks who are wandering the floors in those stores. Go in and ask for help. They'll be happy to help you. I've done it myself. I've seen tons of people doing it, and it's the greatest thing you can do. It's worth that night out. You go and shop for some clothing, and then you walk in and learn some techie stuff.
It's a great suggestion. I'd also like to throw in, a lot of the schools have technical advisors. You can go to them. They'll spend time with you. They have a lot of resources. And again, going back to Verizon, their parenting tools is an excellent resource that really teaches you a lot about technology and what you need to know. So Amy, tell us what you think, though, about this second parenting style.
I love what Hemu said about being at the table and having kids respond and show you what they know as well, because that the real meat of that is that you build a relationship with your kids, and you cannot ask the kind of questions that are required in, you know, where, what sites are you on and what kinds of things are happening, and I'm going to need to see your phone sometimes, unless there is that relationship, because otherwise it just sounds like grilling. So when I am asking those questions and I'm saying, again, it's my job to make sure that things are going well, it's important the kids know we're all new at this. None of us know how to manage ourselves on technology. Even adults mess up. And it's important that perhaps you pull in even some people in the news who it's like, wouldn't it have been great if somebody was there to help them out and let them know, perhaps showing that picture. Taking that picture was not the wisest thing to do. So it is the safeguard. So if they can see your questions as being the safeguard for them rather than your interference, but they're going to think it's interference. So again, making that statement of, this is just my job because we believe in your in caring for you, and we're not willing to let you hang out there if you need some help.
So one thing I was thinking about with this more flexible style where you're assessing each situation is, when you have two parents, you know, what if they're not doing it consistently, and just even one parent not being consistent with it, and when your kids start seeing that you're being inconsistent, sometimes you're being focused and assessing and maybe taking action, other times maybe you're not. How do you handle that?
There's nothing stronger than intermittent reinforcement. So if I think that it could happen any time, then I'm more likely actually to assume that it could happen any time. So just because I haven't done it for a while doesn't mean that it's not going to be hanging in the back of my head that this could be the conversation. And guess what conversations they're going to be thinking you might actually plug into, the very one where they know this would look bad if this were the one that you actually did monitor.
Okay.
So that, you know, that way I don't have to stay on it 24/7. And to also recognize that if you're doing a sampling, that perhaps you did end up getting that, you know, it's kind of like when you get the police ticket, because the speeding ticket, it was the only time that you ever, you know, did a speeding down the right. down Fairmount Boulevard ever. It's like, you just caught me in my one bad moment. So, you know, that's probably not going to be true. But to also take into account that they're going to want you to know that they don't always have those negative moments. That.
Ask this question, which I think is a great one. Do you think by being honest about what you're about to do, that you're only creating, you're encouraging your kid to be more subversive so that they will find other ways to hide what they're doing from you?
Mm-hmm. And I think that if you are, if you're setting up a situation where you're saying, I'm going to try to find out everything I can on you, then they'll go underground. However, if it feels more like everyone on our planet right now needs some support in knowing how to manage this, and this is just our job, we've been doing this all along. We've been doing this when we pay attention to what friends you're going over to and who's going to be there to, you know, to kind of monitor that. This is just another way of our keeping you safe. And if it feels like we're invading your privacy, that's not the intention. And so if you keep it above board, of course they could become more underground. However, that indicates something a little bit more maybe lacking in that relationship building. But if I'm having dinner with you and I care about the other parts of your life and I want to laugh with you and have fun with you, it's less likely that you'll see my monitoring one way or the other, parenting style one or two, as being kind of a negative part of your life. It just is.
How also effective is it, Amy, bringing in, you know, sometimes there are a lot of stories of where things have gone really bad, mm-hmm. and is it really impactful? Do the kids take it seriously when you bring in stories about other teens in different cities and the bad things that have happened to them and why you're trying to do these things to protect them? Do they take that seriously or not?
In order for teens to really look out into the world and become adults, they have to take risks. They have to be risk takers. They have to be very brave. So they want to believe they're invincible, because otherwise it's too scary to leave the nest. It's too scary to become an adult. So no, I don't want to think that that's me. And all of them know people who do worse things than them, and adults who do worse things than them. So it all that does is serve as the statement of, but that's not me, and now you're saying that that's who I am and that's not who I am. So it's more about saying, this isn't about whether we trust you or not trust you. This is about us making a decision to just go in this direction, because we're not really even sure what direction to go in, but we're not willing to risk your well-being in order to find out that we could have let up a little bit.
I like that. Risking your well-being, we're not willing to do that. I think that's a really good point.
Okay. Namu, we're going to move on. What's the third parenting style?
Before I do that, I'll do what I did last time. I just want to add one more thing. One of the interesting things that you talked about was, will they go more will your teens get go underground, in essence? One of the most interesting things I think you'll find is, if the punishment doesn't fit the crime, they're more likely to go underground. So that's something, because we're talking digital, and I'm saying this specifically because we're talking digital tonight, there's parents out there who might feel like they have to have a pretty severe reaction to what, if it happened in the physical world, the same incident, they would have a much more laid-back reaction to. That's something you have to keep in mind. Remember, for your teenager, there's no difference between the online world and the offline world. It is one and exactly the same. For folks like me, we will sit at a table or a desk or go into a house, we'll look under and we'll say, well, is this computer connected to the internet? There's no such conversation in your teen's life that ever occurs, other than, not the phone's not connecting, it's the phone is broken. That's how they see things. Or the laptop's broken when they can't get to Google or some other website. So that remember, so keep in mind that in their mind, they're having a real-world conversation, even though while in your mind, you may be having a digital conversation. Okay. So now let's turn to the third one, which is, are you the kind of parent, and let's go back to when you were younger, are there some of you who are listening or watching right now whose parents kind of left them alone? Do what you want. Go out, come back, it's okay, you'll be fine. But at the same time, you always knew they were there. Somehow or another, they made their presence known. They made the fact that they care about you and that they want you to be responsible for yourself came through. And it could have been done in subtle situations. It could have been done in that every now and then moment that they decided to get involved in something that was going on. And in many ways, my son actually said this to me. He was traveling the through Canada and coming back through the mountains. And one of the things he would do is he would call and check in. He would ask for little questions. He would do things like that. But then he called his ability to reach out to me. That was his home base. So are you the kind of parent that is your child's home base? And that's how I think you have to think about it and say to yourself, now today, can they do whatever they want? And you'll hear it in your own teens' conversation. You may never know about this unless you ask, or if you think about your own past life in when you were younger and you say, was I the kid who was saying, you know what, my parents don't ask, but I know that if I screw up, they'll be right there. Or if there's something going on, they're going to get it. Their instincts are going to go up and they're going to say, hey, honey, what's wrong? What's going on? Are you that kind of parent? And again, there's software that can help you to take that somewhat of a softer touch. And one of the great ones out there is called Net Nanny. And again, you can get it in all sorts of devices and programs and you know, operating systems. So that's our number three.
I have a question for you, which is, where did that question go? If your child, this is from Lethe, if your child goes to, you've put on all these monitoring devices in your own home, but they go to someone else's house, what do you suggest? They go to a public library, although I think there are restrictions at the library.
Well, there are restrictions for library, but one of the things that all teenage kids know, or if they don't, they're going to ask somebody, is how do you get around it? And I think you should assume that every kid who is a teenager today knows how to do what's called go through a proxy, get around all your filters, get around your devices, turn things off, do all those things. But the reality of the situation is that kids, and this is research after research is showing this, those kids who are at risk in the real world, and again, I'm using our terminology, not the teens, but who are at risk in the real world are also just as likely to be at risk online. And the interesting thing is the opposite is also exactly true. If your kids are not at risk in the real world, they're not at risk online. And that's one of those commonalities in the research that keeps coming up. And the reason I'm pointing this out is if your kids are trying to find every which way around that situation, there is, and I'm sure Amy's going to say this more about it, there's something else going on. There is another conversation to be had, and maybe another kind of intervention to be done. But that's, I think, one of the things that we have to think about. It's no different than bedtime, right? We tell our kids, you have to be in bed at 9:30. They go to their room, and then you don't know if they're going to be sneaking under. I actually caught my 9-year-old recently doing this. He had a little light, and he was reading. He was so into some book. He's like, I just wanted to read. And I happened to go into his room for something else, and I thought, there's something not right in this room right now, and there was a light coming from under his blanket, and there you go. So I think there's other things that you have to think about in that situation.
Thank you. That was a great point. Amy, what's your response on the third style?
Yeah, and it's interesting how styles, we think it's going to be this parenting style or this parenting style, but really it also has to do with the kids that you have. So it's not necessarily, I would love to have that style, but I can't have that style because I got these children. And also you might have more than one style kid in your home. So if you've got a kid, like Hemu said, who is showing that they are capable of managing themselves
in most things, that they have, you know, that they've held their school experience together, that they show up on time, that they do their work, that they are, they've got a, you know, that they're starting to drive and they're showing responsibility there, then there's a good chance that you can say, you know, should you need help, let me know, I'm right here. And then, you know, just have kind of a handle on, I've noticed there's something a little bit different about, you know, about your response to things lately, and so I'm curious about that. So having curious questions for kids like that. Then it's hard if you've got another kid in the family where you do need to keep a little closer pace. And just to say, you know, it's just like we don't buy you the same clothes or the same, you know, the same sporting equipments if you're on two different sports teams. We respond to these things based on what you're going to need to move forward in the world in a successful and safe way. And that's our job, to figure out what each of you needs, not what our, you know, just what we're doing collectively.
Okay. Anything, Sue, coming through that people are asking or want to know more about?
Yes. Yeah, so Linda asks, what about asking your teen to unplug at night and bring electronics downstairs? So I think that's a great question.
Well, can I talk about that?
Of course.
Sure, absolutely.
So that's just one of those, what I consider to be an amazing question, and here's why. When we send our kids to bed at night, and traditionally, what did we all do when we went to bed? We would lie in bed until we fell asleep. We'd be assessing the day. We would be processing what happened. We'd be thinking about all the different conversations that happened with boyfriends, girlfriends, somebody you like, somebody you were flirting with, somebody who was talking about gossip at school. And we would have our own assessment of the situation, and then eventually we'd fall asleep. When you send your kids to their room for bedtime and their phone is on and in their room, it's another way of saying you're not really going to bed. You're going to go out into the city where all your friends are hanging out who are awake still, and you're going to hang out with them. And you're going to talk, you're going to text, and every time that beep or that bing or that whatever sound they've chosen for their notification that another text came in, their mind is going to think, I wonder who that was, and they'll just take a sneak peek, a real quick sneak peek. And that's one of the things you have to be aware of. So one of the things you can do and is simply put a basket. Could be outside the door, it could be downstairs, it could be in the hallway. That's just where you drop your thing in, your phone in, your device, things like that. No different than, for example, the decision you have made or that was made for you when you were little and you were begging for a TV in your room. And what did your parents say? No, you can't have a TV in your room. That's not what you do. So remember, physical world parenting doesn't change just because it's digital. So put that same situation in the real world environment that you grew up with and ask yourself, does it make sense to send your kids to their room with their entire world of awake friends following them into it?
I think that's a great point. So I'm going to tell my daughter right now. Things are going to change a little bit tonight when I get home. Okay. So, Namu, how about moving on and sharing the fourth style?
Okay. So now the fourth style is really interesting because there's some positives, and I'm sure there will be debates on this one, whether it's a positive or a negative. But I think the way let's approach it from more of a positive attitude or a positive intention, which is really what happens with most parents when they're trying to parent. So if you go back to your childhood again, were there friends, and maybe you are one of these folks, did you have friends when it was getting close to curfew time and everybody was out and they were calling or they're saying, I need to call my mother because she's going to be mad if I'm not home and if I'm going to be late, I need to tell her. Or somebody who's saying, I got to go now, I got to know now, I'm going to get grounded. And then there was that one kid who was saying, it's no big deal, my mother doesn't care, my father doesn't care, they're busy. Are you that parent, not because you don't care, but because you're thinking to yourself, hey, if I don't get too involved, they'll be okay, they'll figure it out, they'll learn, it's fine, I did it myself. Or everybody knows it'll work out on its own. That's a different kind of parenting style. There's no question we're going to have debates on this where we're talking about, well, at what point do you become more engaged to the next level, the next level, the next level? Or do you maintain that style for, like we were just talking about, different kids need different parenting styles. But there are parents out there who are like that. It's number four in my category of what kind of parent you are. And in the digital age, that becomes something very similar as well, which is very simple. Here's your phone. Here's your iPad. here's your whatever device you're giving them. Let me know if it works. If you have a problem, let me know. I got insurance. We'll get it fixed. And that's the end of the conversation. And in a sense, that safety lesson never gets integrated into it because you figure they know better than you. They'll figure it out. Now, there's also software for that that can somewhat minimize that personality, where you can at least know where they're going, where they may have visited online, what they may have checked out, maybe who they texted with, not what they're saying, but more importantly, in this kind of style, what did they do? How long were they online? How long did they visit a site? All those little things that you can get in a report. There's a software called K9 that does that, the letter K, the number 9, that actually does that for you. And again, that's another one that we can say, check it out.
So Hemu, this one is where you're really not setting a lot of boundaries, but you still have some monitoring, and that's what you're saying is through this canine, you still get some information just to make sure that something isn't going haywire with your kid?
Right, so what you can do is you can look on the site and say, oh, okay, they visited, they used Google today, then they went off to Huffington Post, and then they checked out The Dish, this new site that Jonathan Chabon just created, or they went and visited my site, onlinesafety.tv, which I doubt they would, but let's say they did. So you get a report of what they did. Or they texted with these 7 friends. All you know is their nickname or their online alias, but that's it. You don't get to go deeper than that. You just know what was going on, but you don't know what was being said, which is often that next level of listening to the conversation.
Okay.
So, Hema, we have an interesting question, and I don't know anything about it. I hope you do. Robert asked whether these programs possibly violate new teenage privacy laws, which must disclose that the computer is being monitored and the child has to approve it?
Okay, so the way to think about it is, if a company, such as when you're going to somebody's website, is monitoring what's going on and you know you have teenagers there, you do have to disclose it. That's what those laws are addressing. They're not invading the parent-child relationship. And when it comes to what's in your house and what you own, you can do whatever you want to it. And you can do it quietly, you can do it publicly. It's up to you whether or not you're having that conversation with your teen. That's your relationship. The government hasn't, in this situation, gotten in the middle of that. So at least not to worry about that is probably the best way to answer that.
Thank you. That's a good clarification, a great question. So Amy, what do you feel about this type of style and, you know, pros and cons for the relationships with your children?
So I think that it doesn't necessarily mean that you're not having a conversation about what this means in the parenting style that you've chosen. It could mean that what you're saying to your teen is, I believe that whatever it is that you're intended to learn through this, you're going to learn it, and you're going to be able to handle what you learn. I think it is important to let them know, I'm allowing the consequences to fall into your lap. So it's not that different than, if you don't get your homework turned in on time, or you don't study for that test and you get the F, then you get the F, and then you've got to deal with that. It's, you know, some parents, they're right on that. Did you get your homework done? Have you studied for the test? So it's that same kind of stepping back and allowing the natural consequences to just take form. And I think the big piece for that is that then if you see a real red flag of you could be in danger, and like Hemu said, you know, if kids, it's not going to just show up online stuff, it's going to show up in life overall, that certainly it still requires that we not allow their ultimate safety to be at risk, but we allow them to take some of the consequences of, you know, you're going to have some stuff going on at school, and you're going to have some stuff going on perhaps even legally, and that might just be the thing that will allow you to then shift gears and choose differently in your future.
Okay, great.
So Heidi has a question, which I think kind of relates to this idea of you are online who you are offline. And so she says, a generally responsible and trustworthy child who's deleting texts because they know you sporadically monitor and they simply don't want you to listen to their conversation. Is that worrisome?
I would say that for a big part of all of our conversations, we don't want other people to be a part of that. Ever send the text to the wrong person and then you're like, what was in that text? So, you know, that's a big fear for us, isn't it? That somebody's going to be reading something, because we do say stuff. And I, you know, when I work with teenagers, sometimes they'll say, you know, I do vent with my friends and I don't say it to my parents. So then they get irritated because they read that I said it to my friends. And that's just the way that I'm kind of unloading. And so we do unload with close friends. We unload about all kinds of people in our life, right? So it is hard if you're stepping in and you're reading that. And it is hard not to make judgments about your kids if you know too much about them. However, again, it is that balance between, you know, I need to make sure that you're going in the right direction, or I'm going to trust that you're going in the right direction. And ultimately, it is knowing your kid in real time, in real life, and having conversations about what's really going on inside that's going to make the difference. You'll know them there better than you'll know them by reading what they write to their friends. That's not always who they are.
Amy, one of the things obviously that we've been talking about is just, you know, what you see from a technology perspective is probably how they're going to be even beyond the technology. Are there other things that you would recommend for parents to be more aware of beyond just the technology and the texts and the websites that they're going to? Are there other pieces that you think parents should be, you know, monitoring on their own, not through the technology, but what's going on in their kids' lives, just to make sure they're seeing a holistic picture of what's happening in their child's life?
I think that it's nice to, for instance, I had a dad who was saying that he would come to the house and text his daughter that he was there, and then she would come out. And this was, she was about 13 at the time. And just that we remember that it's okay for us to have interactions with people too. It's okay for me to walk up to the door. And when he said, I didn't want to go into the house because I wasn't sure what I would find, that's my fear that keeps me from being part of this child's world, rather than, you know, than just saying, I'm going to face what it is and we'll deal with it that way. So being curious, I would say that the number one leading force with teens is not to be informational, but to really be curious. What is your view on this, and how are you thinking about this? And when we say, so where are you going? Because I'm just really curious about what your night looks like, rather than I need to really pry in. And if they're fairly open, then pretty much you know that you have this relationship. They could still surprise you and things could go poorly, and we've got to recognize that with teenagers. It could go south fast. However, if you feel like there's that secrecy piece, then perhaps you have a dialogue about that. It feels like you're pulling a piece away, and I'm concerned about that.
Okay. I don't know if you can hear me. Am I on?
Yeah, we can hear you.
Oh, okay, so what I was going to say was you can probably narrow down what we were just talking about to the idea of every time you're having an interaction with your teenager about something that you want to raise, the question really to be asking yourself, not out loud, but just to yourself, is simply, are you going to be passing judgment or are you going to be offering support? Because support comes in questions, it comes in direction, it comes in a conversation, all sorts of ways, but grounded in the notion that you're offering support as opposed to offering judgment. And I think that's something that your teen is going to feel very quickly if you're going in one direction or the other. One is going to shut them off. The other is going to open them up.
Couldn't agree with you more. Great comment. Mm-hmm. Okay, Sue, I think you have one more question for each of them.
Okay, so for Hemu, Lisa asked, if you have an intuition that your child might be likely to make risky choices, even if they haven't already done that, should you immediately start with the highest level of monitoring?
No, I think one of the best things you can do as a parent is have a conversation. And this can be not a conversation about, I think you're going to make risky choices, because a lot of people will think, well, I better get right to the point and confront it. And they're going to be thinking, I don't even know what you're talking about, right? And then all of a sudden, there's a defensive posture on both ends and a battle ensues. So I think one of the things that you can do is when you start getting that sense, that's when you should be asking about the kinds of things they like, the kinds of things they don't like, what do they explore, what are the challenges happening to other kids at school. Some of the best ways your own kids will tell you what's going on in their world is if you're asking about what's going on around them, not with them. And so this is one of the perfect opportunity to be talking about their friends, who they're hanging with, what kinds of challenges they're having, anybody having a fight with anyone, something strange happened, and the next thing you know, they start exploring. And they may, for example, say to you, oh, you know what, Stacy was wanted to try marijuana the other night, and I think she did, right? What she's really saying is somebody actually asked her whether she should, and she's still having a debate in her mind about it, and she's throwing it out there to see what kind of reaction you're going to have. So I think there's all sorts of situations, and Amy can probably give you 15 other examples like that, but it's one of the things to think about really, really carefully, and this goes back to what kind of reaction are you going to have? Are you going to respond to them with certain things without passing judgment, exploring their world, and in that process you're going to find that they open up and that risk factor starts mitigating itself.
Great. That's great. Okay, so we're running out of time, so I have one more question. Mimi asked, are there differences in the way parents monitor boys and girls? Parents should monitor boys and girls.
I think it really is unique to your kid. So, no. I think that there are some girls that are very responsible, some boys that are very responsible, and I think that there are some girls and boys that can go off the deep end. And it is about really paying attention to how able is this kid in taking on this responsibility. In the same way that, you know, boys and girls, some drive great, some need a lot of support. And it is about assessing for this kid, and it helps, I think what Hemu said is really true. It helps if they're a part of that assessment for themselves. You know, we all know that there are times when we hope that somebody kind of has that scaffolding around us still until we're ready to launch. And so it can be a very helpful thing if it's done respectfully.
Okay, thanks.
So before we wrap up, as I said at the beginning of today's webinar, this is actually a second in a series of webinars that we're having. So the next webinar, the third one, is going to be on November 20th at 9 p.m. And it's going to be covering the highly problematic online behaviors of gaming, cyberbullying, and porn. You'll receive a link for the next webinar via an email, so make sure you stay tuned. But we have a short video by Dr. Deborah Gilboa, who's going to introduce the webinar.
Hi, I'm Deborah Gilboa. You might know me as Dr. G. I'm joining Your Teen Magazine for the next episode of this webinar series. We're going to talk about the things that really keep us up at night as parents of tweens and teens. We're going to talk about addiction, cyberbullying, gaming, even pornography. Remember that whatever it is we want our kids to know about those things, we have to tell them, or else the only people they hear from are their peers. So I hope you'll join us at 9 p.m. Eastern on November 20th for the next installment in this great webinar series, and you'll get tips you can really use as you parent your tweens and teens through this digital age.
Okay. Before we go, any final words? Hemu, I'll let you go first.
Oh, am I supposed to give my zinger now?
Yeah.
I think the way to think about it is the world is changing, the technology is changing, but one thing that's not really changing is the lessons that you want to give your kids as they're growing up, and the conversations you're going to have and how you parent is still many ways the way it's always been for hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of years.
Great words. Amy?
And this backs right up to that, that however, whatever parenting style you choose, that it's the values that we instill in our kids that matter. And if you want them to be honest, then be honest with them. And if you want them to be respectful to them. And then they learn that those are the things that matter above all else.
Also really great words. Okay, we'd like to thank Verizon for presenting Your Teen Technology Series. We're really grateful for them, for their commitment to educating parents and teens and their commitment to safeguarding our families. Again, be sure to check out the parenting tools on the Verizon website. I'd also like to encourage all of you to watch some of the wonderful YouTube videos that Hemu has had and Amy has had. You'll learn a lot about technology. You can delve deeper into these topics and even just in parenting in general. So thank you both for being here. It's been really wonderful.
Thank you.
Do you wish your son was studying rather than playing on his phone?
Answer, My Verizon. You're in control with Verizon Family Base. You can set limits on purchases, usage time, and even lock down their device on demand. That's com/myverizon.